Sporty Books presents Faster by Michael Hutchinson, read by Simon Vance. Introduction. An accidental athlete. We all make sacrifices to feed our passions. In my case, I can barely remember the last time I spent the night anywhere other than in a tent, or a terminally lost Arctic explorer, but I'm not. I'm a cyclist. The tent is in my bedroom, which most people seem to feel makes things not quite as adventurous, but no less peculiar. I sleep in it because it simulates high altitude. The air inside has been pumped through a filtration system to reduce the oxygen content from the normal sea level 20.8% to something more like 14%. It's the equivalent of 3,500 meters further up than Europe's highest mountain pass. Sleeping at altitude this way is supposed to give you most of the benefits of altitude training without the inconvenience of living and working at the top of an Alp for 12 months of the year, or moving to Albuquerque. That's not to say there are no downsides at all. The pump makes a noise like an outboard motor. On a warm night, the temperature inside the tent can climb into the unbearable, and on a cold one, the condensation drips down the inside until it saturates the sheets, and I end up trying to sleep on a tiny sliver of dry in the middle of the bed. If I run a small fan inside the tent, it can help with the heat and condensation problems, but then the noise of that combines with the outboard motor to replicate the effect of sleeping on an airliner. The other inconvenience is my partner. Her first introduction to the tent was when she got home from work one night to find it already fully installed. I hadn't had the nerve to mention it. I suppose I hoped the surprise of finding it would distract her from the surprise of how much money had vanished from our bank account to pay for it. Since we lived in a one-bedroom flat, she was either going to have to share it, sleep on the sofa, or just cut her losses and get out of the whole relationship. I didn't show her the bit of the instruction manual that promised suffocation to those who attempted to share the limited air supply. The way I saw it, the less air there was to go around, the higher the effective altitude, and at no extra cost. I was untroubled by how closely this was related to the plastic bag over the head altitude simulation system. This was simply because the tent was something that might help me ride a bike faster. I already trained more or less all day. Now I could use those wasted hours of sleep to sneak another gain. I'd have bought the tent even if the warning was one of a random 30% chance of sudden death. Anything for speed. I like to think that none of the foregoing would make anyone question my sanity. But even I have to admit that a rational man would have his doubts when I say that to this day I have no idea whether the tent and all its associated costs and aggravations actually made me any faster. The theory is sound. There have been a few reasonably good scientific studies, but even the best of those only claims it makes a relatively small difference for some people, sometimes. For me, perhaps multiplied by perhaps is enough. It's not just the tent. In the same period, I rode somewhere around 175,000 miles. I owned around 50 bikes, each one of which I was convinced was going to go faster than the previous one. I even spent a morning riding round Manchester Velodrome's track in the nude in an attempt to find out if bare skin was faster than a lycra suit. It wasn't, and thank God for that. I spent hours in laboratories being tested and measured. I'm an unusual physical specimen, so there was never any shortage of physiologists keen to poke and prod. I found out all manner of unlikely things about myself. I had what was reckoned to be just about the highest ratio of lung capacity to height, measured in a UK lab, for instance, that would have made interesting, if creepy, conversation starters at parties, if I had not been so scared of catching a cold that I avoided parties at all costs, along with cinemas and concerts. I sat on planes with a polo neck jumper pulled up to just below my eyes, like Wilfred from the Bash Street Kids. I lived in a world where, one way or another, everything was divided into things that might make me faster and things that might make me slower. Pretty much anything pleasant fell into the second category. Eating sensibly makes you faster. A couple of beers make you slower. A quiet evening with your feet up to recover from a hard day on the bike makes you faster. A night out with your friends makes you slower. But misery and loneliness make you slower, too. You don't have to be happy, and you almost certainly aren't, but you have to be able to function sufficiently to get up, have a kilo of porridge for breakfast, and get on your bike. Even the most committed have to choose between speed and sanity. So the question is, how much more committed will you be to next week's workload if you go out for a drink and try to get riding right, eating right, and thinking right out of your mind for an hour or two? Will you lose 3% of the week's progress but gain 4%? Always running in the background is an app that asks, how do I go faster? I never meant for any of this to happen. I never even wanted to be an athlete. My ambition was to be an academic lawyer, and by my mid-20s that's exactly what I was. I taught slightly left-wing civil liberties and human rights courses to first-year undergraduates at Sussex University. Since most of the students had their hearts set on becoming big-shot lawyers for major corporations, my job was overshadowed by the unspoken irony that my flock was almost certainly going to spend more time oppressing minorities than defending them. I wasn't really too bothered by this, nor by knowing that they'd earn 5 times my salary while they did it. But I was driven to despair by the interminable Wednesday afternoon meetings of the faculty staff. Hours spent achieving nothing in an airless 1960s seminar room where the unjustified use of a gender-specific pronoun was fighting talk. We would debate such things as the political significance of the sign on the women's toilet featuring a figure standing legs together, and the men's featuring one standing legs apart. Or rather, older members of the faculty would debate it, while I and a couple of the younger members of staff would pass each other sarcastic notes about them under the table. By then I'd been cycling for a couple of years, and I was getting quite good at it. I'd begun spending my weekends travelling up and down the UK to national level races. I often abandoned work at lunchtime to do a few hours training, making up the time by working into the night. I resented every minute spent in the faculty meeting because it was a minute I wasn't on my bike. This quickly progressed to resenting every minute of my job because it was a minute I wasn't on my bike. My contract came up for renewal, and I don't think I even bothered going to the interview. Maybe it happened one Wednesday afternoon while I was down the corridor trying to work out which toilet to use. I went to a research job at a different university. Or rather, I took the money and the accommodation and spent my time cycling. A successful season followed. A bike manufacturer offered me a contract to go full-time. The money wasn't great, and it would almost certainly be the ruin of my proper career. And it was so. But I said yes anyway. The obsession with faster had taken hold, and the chance to work at it undistracted by any more grown-up responsibilities was too much to resist. In some ways, nothing I've done since in the pursuit of speed has been quite as irrational. It led me into an odd career. I was a time trial specialist, and I was in the only country in the world where you could conceivably make a living doing that. Unlike everywhere else, in the first few years of the 21st century, the UK was still obsessed with time trialing as the bedrock of the sport. It suited me perfectly. Unlike mass start road racing, TTing is an event for the analytical. It rewards hard work, knowledge, and research. It's about control in racing and training, about measuring efforts perfectly and concentrating on what you're doing. It's not mercurial. It's not especially interesting to watch, if I'm honest, at least not for a casual spectator. But it's the purest form of bike racing, and it finds the strongest riders. It's about speed, and nothing more. If you want to win a time trial, all you have to do is be the fastest rider in the race. There are no tactics, no teams, just you. From the inside, it is fascinating, and it fascinated me. There was another reason I was happy with it. My career coincided with the dirtiest era in international pro cycling. That was where my background probably made a very serious difference to my riding. I didn't grow up as a star-struck kid dreaming of a life in cycling or in any other sport. I bumbled into it almost by accident, and at an age where I was quickly under no illusions about how pro cycling worked. I didn't have hopes dashed or agonizing choices to make between my dreams and my honesty. I knew what that world was like, and I wanted nothing to do with it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.